I'm Grace Powell. I'm in Jacob, and you're colliding with Yale Magazine.
Jacob Kale. His eyes were black and lifeless.
Jacob!
The older that boy gets, the bigger he gets, and the stronger he gets. One of these days, that boy's gonna go too far, and he ain't gonna be able to turn back. Jacob!
Billy, I found Sissy!
Robert Englund summed it up best. He looked at it and he's like, this is a Mice and Men meets Friday the 13th, which is, it is. It's pretty close to that. You know, that's your elevator pitch. But basically, Jacob's the story of Jacob. He's this 16-year-old kid who's very big. He's like 6'5", weighs like about 400 pounds. And he hears these voices all the time in his head. They're telling him to do things like take cats apart and burn down a neighbor's barn. And they speak to him, telling him to do bad things.
As like a more of a childlike mind, you know, if I'm literally these voices, I don't even have the comprehension to know that they're voices, you know, they're literally in my head. Right. Kind of undertone of the movie, a lot like The Shining, you know, there's other influences kind of pushing me towards things. You know, the voices are not, I'm not schizophrenic, these are actual voices, because I'm not the only one hearing them.
A relationship between me and Jacob.
By Jacob's little sister, but she has enough snap that she just tunes him out, doesn't listen. She tells Jacob, that's not right, don't do that. She keeps him straight. And that all works really good in theory until the stepdad comes home drunk one day and something really tragic happens, sends Jacob off in a rage, and he murders half the town in one night.
Well, the motherfucker ain't back here, Edith. God damn! Hard to leave this motherfucker and not come back. Fucking kids. My shit, Edith!
I'm sorry.
I don't want your goddamn kids touching my shit!
I'm sorry, Otis.
I'm sorry, this won't happen anymore.
You know why I keep my shit there? Maybe when I want to hear my fucking music, I can come over here and get my goddamn albums like this, and I can listen to it. Unless the motherfucker ain't there, Edith!
We did all our own stunts. I mean, it was just that whole room was in a studio set, okay. And so they told us, you know, feel free just to break everything. And I thought that was green light for me. I was like, yes, let's just. I mean, I was scoping, like, I want to break that lamp. That table's gone. You know, but it was. But at one point in the night, I looked down, and there's a safety pin stuck about an inch into my foot, and I just had no idea, because it was so visceral, and you were just so pumped the whole time.
Now, Dylan, who plays Jacob, I popped him a good two or three times in the head.
He clocked me in the face full on twice. I mean, because, you know, he punches me 5 or 6 times. We did that scene maybe, you know, 10 or 11 takes. Mm-hmm. Especially with this movie, you know, it's one of those things where you would have the perfect scene. I mean, perfect. And you want one more for safety.
Those were pretty tense nights. Mm-hmm. And my big direction to the cast was no false moments. You know, to me, that's something that really just ruins a movie for me, is if I look and I tell that the actors aren't in it, and you just like, you're not in it, why am I in it?
I mean, I felt like I was in a barroom ball. I mean, we were both bruised all over, bleeding. Yeah, it was good.
He got me back. He like actually cracked a rib when he ripped my arm off in that scene.
That was awesome.
I had it coming.
Yeah.
Inspiration was drawn from all sorts of things. I think that anybody creative kind of does that. You pull from things that you love. Even like musicians, you know, you may have five guys that come together to make a band, and maybe the drummer's like really heavily influenced by Jason Bonham, and maybe the guitar player's like all into Randy Rhoads, and the singer may be into opera. But when these guys come together, it makes some kind of new form of music that didn't exist before, and it's really drawn from all these things. Mm-hmm. Well, even as a writer and a filmmaker, I have all kinds of movies I love. I love Frankenstein.
And also Frankenstein and the person that kind of made him.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess there's that. I don't know. I watched it a long
time. Well, it's the scene I'm most drawing on is when Jacob's carrying you through the cemetery.
Oh, yeah.
And Frankenstein does that. In directing Grace as a child actor, and you wrote the script as well, mm-hmm. were there any things that you weren't comfortable doing or that you decided on set to not do or change from the original script because you had an impressionable child actress on stage?
No, not at all. We all knew like what we were getting into.
It wasn't really scary once you're there and they're like, oh, I forgot to make the blood. Somebody go get the red dye. It's not scary once you see how it all
is put together. And did you do anything to help out on set?
I loved to help our special effects person make the blood.
Okay.
So I would always just help her, and it was a lot of fun.
Okay, and now do you play practical jokes on your friends with fake blood?
I have used it for theater before.
Okay.
But I haven't done that. I'll definitely need to try that now.
Okay.
One thing that was important to me that wanted me to kind of gave me the decision that I wanted to direct was because I had written it and I knew the story so well and I knew the characters, if I got in a situation on a set where we were shooting and something wasn't working, or if I saw something that was more interesting than what I'd written, and sometimes you get a chemistry going on set and you can just feel this kind of magic and you're like, this is good, let's go with this. I wanted that to be able to make that call and say, okay, let's go this direction. And that happened a lot. There was many times that what we were shooting had just exceeded what I had even imagined in the first place.
Right. A couple of scenes, you know, just the emotion from Grace's parents just showed you, I mean, how, and they, I mean, they know, I mean, they're on a movie set, and it's still, they were still just caught up in it.
Yeah. Did you ever feel protective of her?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, the entire movie, we're still, we're still that way now. It's,
okay.
I mean, awesome. for as long as we shot, I mean, by the time we're done, it's like, Grace is like my second, you know, little sister / pseudo daughter, you know.
Yeah.
We'd already filmed a lot of the stuff in the shed, so we were just already like, it wasn't kind of that awkward thing where you just first met somebody, we were already pretty close, so it was very easy for me to have that.
He got it. He got it and he nailed it perfectly. And part of that also, it comes through his relationship with Grace and that chemistry. You know, that's the heart of the movie, and the movie does have heart, and it's because of those two.